So I was expecting that that with the introduction of this session, that we'd be moving to a slightly edgy area, in that the interface between the needs and interests of researchers, however aligned in terms of the kinds of questions we might ask and the kinds of answers we seek, and how policy directed there are, but putting aside that we probably are widely aligned, and I expected we'd be widely aligned in terms of agenda for health and human services, I did not anticipate the alignment that, at least as the conference has gone this far this morning, that we'd begin to see in terms of where the different roles might fit in between what academics want in this space and what state agencies and others might feel is appropriate or even possible. So again, what I want to do in the next couple of minutes is to introduce this session by pointing out the way very, very, very generically academics may view the world in terms of where we contribute, how we contribute, and what's important from the academic point of view in order to make this a sustainable activity from a professional point of view. So the context in which I raise this is that Andy Krakow, who you all know and who kicked us off this morning, came down here about 18 months ago to discuss the very question that's on the table in the next hour, which is where academics and folks in the both the state agency and in the health advocacy space might effectively collaborate around open data. And although the initial ask, if you will, was for cooperation and participation and perhaps technical assistance in the general space of IT and in data visualization and things that, at least in the imagination, folks at Stanford should be quite good at, and I'm certainly not, but some of my colleagues have these skills, it became clear as our dialogue with Andy progressed that there were some deeper ways in which we could work together. And that's kind of what I'd like this session to get at. So there are two things that I think academics, broadly speaking, can bring to the table, separate from just the mere collection of the data and bringing it forward in terms of its access and presentation to various users. So on the one hand is our ability to do analysis. And again, I would make the case, I think it's probably pretty straightforward, that within the walls of academia here, within the UC system and throughout the state, there are fantastic assets that can not only answer questions of simple data linkage to make that data available, but to actually go a step further with the data. So, for example, this morning, Mike proposed that it would be really nice if we could link data across agencies to understand, when we start making cuts, whether there was a subset of the population that was jointly affected or mutually affected by multiple cuts. And I would turn that around and say, here's an even more interesting question. Which of those various services actually add value in families that are receiving multiple services? And can we actually start looking at not return from investment as primarily a financial question, but as a health question, as a human services question? This is not something that linking the data by itself is going to lead to. We can, moreover, look at mechanisms. So if it turns out that providing support in one dimension has terrifically more value than providing support in another, we can actually try and explain that. And again, these are the capabilities of social scientists and analytics and analysis analysts that work in the academic space. And finally, and not unimportantly, I think we potentially add the whole area of validating various interpretations or disagreeing with various interpretations of the data as it's analyzed. And again, is in the broad effort to bring the public into the same space that we're all beginning to live in, these issues and the roles that academics can play in support of various interpretations of these data and their policy ramifications, more taxes or less taxes, redistribution of state resources and so forth, would obviously be very important. Of course, we need things in return for that. And I think some of the questions this morning began to hint at it. And again, I was very, very pleasantly pleased to see how aware most of the folks in the room appear to be about what those needs turn out to be. But I want to outline them because to the extent that there are going, as we move forward, to be areas of public concern and agency concern and government concern, some of those are recapitulated on this slide. So as I think was evident from some of the questions, academics need granular data. And not only does that data need to be granular, often down to the individual level, not always, but certainly smaller than state, for example, to take one of the questions this morning. The data need to be linkable, and not linkable necessarily just for display purposes, but for analysis purposes. So that, for example, just looking at the criminal justice data that was shown this morning, knowing exactly which blocks and neighborhoods are more severely versus less severely affected by threats, violence threats, allows the possibility of studying the implications of violence on public health, for example, to be far better than if you're looking at it at the level of county or even census tract and so forth. So linkability is critical. Finally, as we're going to hear later, or next, as we're going to hear a little bit later in the session, we live in a world in which increasingly people are skeptical about data and skeptical about analysis of data and want to be able to see it reproduced if there are questions about its veracity, and even within the scientific community, a huge drive to make data shareable, reproducible, verifiable, all of which, of course, begin to get at the whole edge between sort of privacy and sharing and the concerns that are raised by that. And finally, an area that I think is probably not widely on the public radar screen, but certainly is in an academic environment, is that academics to work on these things need to be able to generate academic product, even if many of the important products of that work are direct application in real time. But in the end of the day, none of us gets promoted without being able to publish, which means some control over the use of the information to at least be able to assure that. So ironically, some of our best journals, scientific journals, on the one hand, demand that every single shard of data be public and posted and reproducible. And on the other hand, they won't allow a word of it to be leaked a minute before the publication appears. If it's shown up in the New York Times, they're not interested. A little bit of a contradiction, but it's the world we live in. Anyway, we have a fabulous panel this morning to sort of tee up some of these issues from various points of view. I'll shut up. First, I just want to introduce Elizabeth Baca, who was stolen by the state from our midst, a former member of our Division of General Pediatrics and a very, very highly regarded faculty member here, who now works in the Governor's Office of Planning and Research as a senior health policy analyst. Elizabeth.
Oh, great. Thank you. And I imagine the slides are going to come up.
They're supposed to.
All right. Well, thank you, Mark. And it's really exciting to be back. I was coming down with a colleague, and it's really fun just to see all of the buildings and to see some of the faculty again. And also, it's just an honor. I wanted to say thanks to stewards and everyone who made today possible, because I think thinking about these data issues, I've been thinking about this for a long time. And so it is fun, as Mark said, to see the conversation moving forward. I think part of being on this panel, exploring the intersection between open data and academic research, really comes from the fact that I used to be in the academic world and the academic milieu thinking about some of these issues and now get to be at the state. And so as Stuart and Mike mentioned, there are unique challenges, but I think there are also a lot of unique opportunities. I think one of the things that why is this question so important at this juncture? And I think a lot of it really has to do with, it's kind of going back to Daniel's slide this morning around health and human services. And I think there's been this really growing paradigm shift in health and what is health and healthcare, and not just healthcare, but health and well-being. And a lot of that is from the social determinants. And I love, one of my favorite quotes is from Albert Einstein, that we cannot solve our problems with the same level of thinking that created them. And I think this is really where we can be creative in how we start to think about how we use data to really improve the health of populations. So when I was here, I sometimes joke that I think I led some of the pediatric residents and medical students astray, because we were talking about screening for all of these issues. We really were thinking about, what is the food, you know, do our families food secure? Are they insecure? What is the access to park space? What are the housing conditions like? Is the housing affordable? And how does that influence, you know, if their health and well-being and their asthma management? And so, you know, we've really moved it. I think a lot of it has been at the individual level, but we're increasingly starting to think about these different types of data layers. So housing, I love the slide that came up earlier, unemployment, living conditions, work environment. And, you know, I spend a lot of my time now thinking about population health and healthy communities. And so I think there's this real emergence of data coming together in this space. One of the pieces is that it's really been this transition. So we, you know, back, you know, probably in the last 10 years, we started to think about data and just thinking about these platforms or these dashboards. And so we would see things like, you know, what's the tuberculosis look like? What is the voter turnout? Who has health insurance? And that was a really great start to think about getting some of this public into the open domain. But we, you know, it really continued to progress. And so we went from kind of more of the static dashboards to thinking more about geospatial information. This is an example from the Robert Wood Johnson Health Foundation of starting to think about this, and I think this one was maybe park access, so access to different amenities. But you can look across the spectrum of some of these kind of social, economic, and environmental factors. So we've continued to see this level of sophistication. This one is, this is a shout out to Kevin, we didn't touch base, but this is an example of really starting to take data that's open and make it more actionable in the public realm. And I think this is a really fantastic example of how can you make it seamless so that it's more usable. So this is actually a Yelp review from one of my favorite go-to restaurants in San Francisco for special occasions. And you can see that their health score is 98 out of 100, so that's reassuring. I will continue to go there. But I think it's really like as you're making decisions, how do you really get the data out there to be user friendly in different ways? And so that's, I kind of think, where hopefully our discussion will go today around this piece around academic medicine and open data. And there are a lot of challenges around the granularity of data, but you know, is there an opportunity to reconceptualize even how we bring that data in or incorporate it? So a couple of examples, and I think this is really, my sense is this is gonna really be the next frontier of being able to close that loop on using the open data and being able to integrate it in more real time. So when I used to teach, the residents would, you know, they would screen for these questions. So if we were asking something about food insecurity and a family screen positive, we would go to, and this was out in East Palo Alto, so we would get the 211 book, and we would write down different services. And it wasn't really like a seamless process, right? And then you'd call the thing, and then they were like, well, the book went into publication 5 months ago, and now the program's moved. So you were spending a lot of time going, you know, through processes that could really, with technology, and with this access to open data, really be much more seamless. So this is an example of a project that was done, the Ohana API that was done here in San Mateo County to really start to take some of those services online. The picture down here is from Chicago, so this is Purple Binder, and so they're really looking at the social determinants of health and housing, food pantries, and other different types of services that can come into the clinical record. And one of the other really interesting, and I think we're going to have a discussion on some of the open data initiatives and use of data in different ways, is happening in Chicago of actually using data and housing data, which we work with a lot in the Office of Planning and Research, to look at old housing stock and do predictive analytics and modeling to be able to predict lead poisoning and then intervene at an earlier point instead of waiting to screen and then seeing that the lead levels are high. The last example that I have on here is from Cullen Viral Screen. So this is just one of the types of data. So we do a lot of work with local communities and governments across the state, particularly around planning and land use. And so as you're thinking about what types of data is out there, Cullen Viral Screen is increasingly, one of the tools we use it for funding. We also look at some of the different environmental exposures. But just to kind of spark the discussion around how do we start to use some of this thinking about risk profiles or thinking about maybe tailoring services in ways to really leverage that. And then on the opposite side, where are these programs having the biggest effect? So on that, I'm going to say thank you and then launch and listen to the other panel discussions and then launch into discussion. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Now to underscore that other H in HHS, Emily Putnam-Hornstein, who is an assistant professor at the School of Social Work at USC, who has graciously agreed to fill in at the last minute for one of her senior colleagues. Emily is the director of the Children's Data Network, and I think is going to show us a little bit about what data linkage can do. Thank you.
Terrific. So pleased to be here, excited to join the conversation. I should warn everyone, since I am kind of the last minute stand-in, my reflections are going to be very candid because I was pulling them together last night and I figured this is a perfect chance to really kind of lay it out there. So, you know, how is it that and why is it that this marriage is in fact quite challenging to navigate between the public sector and universities? Just to kind of back up, I am at USC, but my academic career really started at Berkeley, where I still maintain an appointment. And one of the things that I learned at Berkeley while partnering on the California Child Welfare Indicators Project, which is one of the earliest and most longstanding exemplars for how universities can partner with the public sector around open data, was the real importance of relationship building. So that's certainly one thing I'm going to talk about. But the other thing that I quickly discovered is that open data is just not that interesting to most researchers. And I'm just going to put it out there. Open data is great for lots of purposes, but researchers really do need the level of granularity to be able to longitudinally follow populations and children over time to look at the sequencing of encounters and experiences and to really be rigorous in documenting what the outcomes are. Now, I realized that, trust me, all of my public sector colleagues also realized that, but the interesting irony was that through the work I was doing at Berkeley, I found that I was often in a better position to enter into data sharing agreements that were going to give me access to the identifiable data needed to actually link and begin to create some of these longitudinal data resources than were my colleagues in the public sector. And the reason for that was simply that it was very, very clear. I was a researcher. I was operating under the state's Committee for the Protection of Human Subject, under USC's or UC Berkeley's IRB protocols. There was no question I was not going to have contact with human subjects. And I was very clearly able to document why the identifiable data was, in fact, the minimum needed for me to carry out the end objectives of the research. So I actually had a decent amount of success as a doctoral student gaining access to other administrative data, did lots of linkages with birth records, death records, some substance abuse records, partnered on an educational record linkage project. But what was incredibly painful throughout that whole process was the tremendous inefficiencies that each of those projects kind of created. It was incredibly burdensome and inefficient for my public sector colleagues who had to devote substantial resources to getting kind of one-off data use agreements in place. It was incredibly inefficient for me as a researcher and my colleagues because, you know what, these data were not collected for research purposes, so they don't come with pretty code books all cleaned up and standardized, so there's inherently this steep learning curve that comes each time you begin working with some of the administrative data. And then, very, very painfully, at the end of that project, this incredible resource that has been created, that at that point is completely de-identified, or at least a very limited data set, almost inevitably had to be destroyed. So it couldn't be put out there for other researchers to use to answer different questions, future questions. It was done. It was a one-off project, and it ended. So I'm very fortunate right now to be directing a new project down at the University of Southern California that is being developed in partnership with our colleagues at the California Child Welfare Indicators Project at UC Berkeley, funded through First Five LA, the Hilton Foundation. Robert Wood Johnson just came as a funder. And what we're really trying to do is serve as a proof of concept for how we can do a better job using available data to link it and look at the trajectories of children and really generate kind of new knowledge that's applicable, that's relevant, that's program and policy important. Now, I don't know how many of you have heard of this study. I think we have some colleagues at Stanford to thank for closing this down. But this was, in some ways, what we're trying to do at the Children's Data Network is exactly what this study was trying to do, but for a few hundred thousand dollars as opposed to $1.3 billion. So this was a very, very ambitious project where the vision was to be able to follow 100,000 children prenatally through age 21, have it be a nationally representative sample, collect tremendous amounts of data. And as best I can tell, all that really happened was a few pilot sites were set up, $1.3 billion was blown, and a few reports were written about how this actually was not, in fact, a very good strategy. Now, I'm not going to oversell what we can ask and answer with administrative data, but it kills me that we actually do collect really good data here in California and that we don't make better use of it, and that that's true nationally. And so I do think that we need to start thinking about how we use retrospective data to answer prospective questions. So that's my little kind of soapbox speech. Now, what are the challenges? And to be honest, I know there are a bunch of folks from Berkeley here, Stanford, UCSF. In some ways, I'm probably going to be harsher on the academic university side of things than I will on the public sector. So obviously, in universities, we do have this culture of publish or perish. As Mark pointed out, we have the challenge of wanting to kind of sit on findings that our agency partners probably wanted last week and asking them to wait, you know, 9 months while we go through a peer review process before it can be published. Another part of the problem, I think, is that we have kind of a funding hierarchy in academic institutions. Everybody wants the NIH funding, and one of the reasons everybody wants the NIH funding is, yes, it is more prestigious, so it's one part science. Supposedly it went through this rigorous peer review process. But let's be honest, it's also about the indirect funds that come into the universities from those sources. And so for those of us who are working on topics that are not on the kind of the top of the NIH or other federal research entities funding list, we're looking primarily to contracts or philanthropic dollars. And those are not as welcomed in universities. And often it's a kind of a hard negotiation with deans and universities to bring those dollars in. I still think there's a tremendous amount of snobbery around administrative data. I always joke that while I don't have tenure yet, I'm super lucky I got a job, because while everybody's excited about big data and administrative data now, even a few years ago, I was told that what I was doing was not, quote, real research, even though it had been published in American Journal of Public Health, American Journal of Epidemiology, but it wasn't real research because of the source of information I was using. There is widespread disinterest in evaluations, not viewed as kind of true science, even though right now the Children's Data Network is working on a project with Orange County where we are using linked administrative data, and they've agreed to roll out a randomized intervention in their community where we can very cost-effectively use data already being collected to evaluate whether, in fact, this intervention is having an impact. It also, to kind of do this kind of work and to partner well, requires a real investment of time that very, very few academics are either willing to make or able to make. You know, I spend probably more time sitting in meetings with my public sector colleagues than I do in faculty meetings, which, by the way, I'm thrilled about. But it's, you know, even at USC, you know, where that falls in terms of service and what the role of universities, what role universities should play in supporting kind of the public sector and the public good, I think is still something that hasn't quite been sorted out. So a tremendous amount of relationship building needed to build that trust. Obviously, there's a big investment needed when it comes to data curation and the metadata documentation. And last but not least, I hope I don't insult anyone here. I always joke that my husband probably has Asperger's syndrome too. But let's be honest, a lot of academics are not actually very good at explaining or translating their findings. So they go out into community meetings, and the number of times I've been in community meetings where people will come up to me and they're like, so embarrassed to admit this, but I think that's the first time I actually understood what a researcher was saying. That shouldn't be the case. So maybe we need to do a better job training our students, but that should not be the case. Now, on the public sector side, there, of course, are challenges there, too. Again, I'm being a little bit more pointed towards the universities, but obviously, a lot of times these questions need to be answered not 2 years from now, but this week. And I wish it was simply that the public sector was so urgent to suddenly use evidence to kind of change course. But usually, or not usually, sometimes it's because there's a scandal or because there's a legislator who demands some information. So there is that challenge that we're perhaps not as well prepared or thoughtful about what types of questions we should be asking and answering on an ongoing basis, and we end up being reactive. And frankly, when you are reactive, it's very hard for the universities to support that work that quickly. Again, I mentioned this already, but it's very, very, we create lots of burdens on our public sector partners because it's not easy to extract, document, and hand off data to researchers. I was meeting with some colleagues in LA's Department of Mental Health the other day, and they were saying how one of the things they were most excited about with the CDN is that we were actually going to work with them to create some good metadata documentation around some of the derived fields that were going to be done in partnership and concert with the agency, because they said, we had a situation where we handed off data to one researcher, we handed off data to another researcher, neither really knew the data well enough to kind of code things as according to some standardized, agreed upon definitions we have internal to the agency. And then, you know what, we're having to field questions and kind of answer why it is there's one number over here that totally doesn't match a number over here, right? So that's something that that I think we can really work on. Researchers gone wild. Of course we want intellectual freedom, but we need to keep in mind that this needs to be a true partnership, and running off to kind of again, I will tell you, I've worked with a lot of public agencies. No one has ever, ever tried to curb anything that I've written or any intellectual freedom that I wanted. But I am also very, very careful to make sure that if I get a call from a reporter, I am letting my partners on the public sector side know that a reporter has called. There might be a story coming. Here's what they're asking about. Not because there's anything they're going to do, but because nobody wants to be caught off guard by that, right? And one of the things that pleases me the most is now it's often the other way around, that I have kind of agencies pointing reporters in my direction because they know that I'm not going to just kind of run my mouth and say stupid things. Well, I might, but I haven't yet, hopefully. Kind of just two last things. Of course, we want to bring as much statistical rigor to the work that we're doing. But as a very smart colleague once said to me, if I cannot see it in a 3x3 table or a chart, the findings are probably so far removed from any real implications for practice or policy that they just don't matter. So I do think that we need to also be mindful that, frankly, if we build the true partnerships, we'll be able to use the data to answer more kind of abstract, esoteric questions. But we also need to be responsive to answering the questions that are applied and actionable. And it's really important. I guess the final one is that I've found it's really challenging because I have a lot of agency partners where I truly think that they would be happy to release the data, but they don't see anything in state statute that clearly says they can release the data. So I think that that's where we kind of need to have a broader conversation about what is or isn't allowed, because it's fascinating. There's data that I happen to know researchers in other states are able to get. There's nothing in state statute that would prohibit it, but the interpretation around what could be released at what level of granularity is not all that clear. So those are my candid observations. I will pass it off to the next person. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Emily. You did a lot of work in a short period of time.
In any event, just so it's crystal clear to everybody that the dialogue we're having requires the involvement and thoughtfulness of our colleagues on the IT side, which is kind of at least the skill set that that many of us on the research side don't entirely have. So it's a pleasure to introduce Scott Chrisman, who has the Chief Information Officer responsibility at HHS and is in particular responsible for the data portal, open data portal at Access at OSHPD.
I don't have any slides except for on my phone, so. Good morning, everybody. And actually, I'm actually the CIO for the Office of Statewide Health Planning and Development, so I appreciate administrative data very, very much. But I'm actually here wearing another hat, and I've been coordinating the Health and Human Services Open Data Initiative that the Undersecretary spoke to this morning for the last year and a half or so. I want to talk a little bit more, reiterate some of the things that Mike shared this morning, and then talk a little bit about some of the things that we're moving towards that I think will be of at least, hopefully, some value to the research community in that vein. So, you know, in terms of the process, Mike provided a great overview. There's a few things I wanted to stress, and actually speaking of technology, I think it was very important for us as we approached this, not as a technology project. It was really about processes. It was about the processes to safeguard data that Health and Human Services as an agency stewards. And certainly much of that is sensitive, and privacy is something of critical importance, the constitutional right in California. So, and that's the environment in which we work. You know, the other comment, hearkening back to some of the comments actually Daniel made this morning, a key aspect of the approach, again, as an agency was health and human services, and the fact that, yes, there obviously is a tremendous amount of value in the health information collected by the various departments in HHS. Likewise, there's a tremendous amount of value in the human services side, and again, looking at sort of the entire spectrum of HHS, it was important to approach it in that fashion, and that was something that Mike emphasized early on, that it is a CHHS effort, not just a health effort. Likewise, I think the partnership with the California Healthcare Foundation has been tremendously important in that, and all the focus on healthcare and the foundation, they've been equally supportive of this health and human services approach. Beyond that, just a couple of notes to share. I think you'd mentioned metadata. That was something that we focused on quite a bit because once, you know, the Department of Public Health, OSHPD, Social Service, a few other departments, have some, you know, quite a bit of data management or data management practices and a long history in that. Many of the departments don't. And so, you know, it was important that we went in and talked about the value of data, the fact that these are assets that they are stewarding and managing, and that there's value that will accrue beyond the walls of government if we make those available in open formats, which was, you know, the point of the initiative as we proceed. And that was critical. And it wasn't, I stress, it wasn't for any malice aforethought that, you know, we want to retain these. I was actually quite intrigued to find that it was more a matter, you know, these are things that we do in the course of administering program requirements. We're delivering a program, and it simply, you know, hadn't really occurred in an obvious fashion that those data in and of themselves have value beyond simply administering program requirements. And so that was an important part of the conversation. And again, it's been driving some of the cultural change that Mike described, at least the conversation around data as an asset, again, across these 12 departments that are very, very diverse and very, very different. Educating on metadata was critical because, as you can imagine, many of these systems, they're very disparate systems that source these assets, and documentation varies widely. And so, you know, focusing on not only the processes of preparing data and prioritizing and then publishing it, but accompanying it with standardized and rich metadata that describes, the asset was of critical importance, and we focused a lot of time on that, and a lot of education. That was much of the process. And again, understanding it once it goes out the door, any possible use you can be made with that. So as much information can be embedded there was critical. I think there was a lot of conversations about the potential for misuse and misinterpretation, and that's understandable. That made metadata all the more important. Is that, you know, capture that, appropriate use, inappropriate use, put in methodologies that were used for that. So this was a lot of the work that's been involved in this in the last, in the last year and a half as we've proceeded. I think some of the other items just to touch on, allowing for this larger conversation with departments about the value of data and the fact that we do need to sort of administer these appropriately and make them available as widely as possible and as an agency, and as an agency with a single face, because clearly there's going to be many of the departments have stakeholders that understand and have relationships, but beyond that, there's a much wider audience of stakeholders in terms of sort of community level interest that don't know who OSHPED is, and they don't know who Department of Aging is, or they just know that there's kind of an interest in sort of the health of the community, or the health and the social services, the social welfare of the community, and so that was part of the process. And again, it has allowed for any number of other conversations as an agency. The last piece really, it's allowed for really a model implementation of governance across these departments. So one of the things that was happening in parallel, actually, was the agency was standing up what was focused primarily on IT governance, but we included a critical component of data governance in that across the 12 departments and three offices. That had representation from many of the departments sitting on committees. So the data governance subcommittee is a place where several of us participate, and we were able to sort of seat the open data effort there, and it provided a venue for collaboration, sort of constant communication, support structure, and all the things that governance brings along with it, as well as the appropriate vetting and adherence to processes to make sure the data being safeguarded and such. But going back to the points that Mike had shared, it also really fostered this sort of peer-to-peer collaboration that was somewhat unanticipated, where folks are just either working through the work group together or just working outside of that to get things done around the open data initiative. In addition to that, as part of the governance structure and really pertains to this and is very important, is an effort that has really been led out by the Department of Healthcare Services, the Medi-Cal program, around data de-identification guidelines and providing a standard set of instruction for the departments who, again, many of the departments aren't accustomed to looking at personally identifiable information and aggregating it to such a point that you can minimize the risk of re-identification. That is just not necessarily in their practice. Certainly public health and OSHPED and others, but many are not, and we wanted to provide, again, a sort of a uniform opportunity, a uniform set of guidance and instructions to allow for that. And so that's something that's in process now. We have all 12 departments engaged in providing input and feedback to those guidelines. But going forward, the intention is really to use those to move at least some of the confidential data through kind of the standard process and begin to publish more on in an open data sense that's been appropriately aggregated, again, standard process, so it's at least comparable in that sense, but again, minimizes and reduces any risk of re-identification. So that's one strategy that we're actively engaged in to try to get kind of move the needle a little bit in the direction of open, while still maintaining those important firewalls to safeguard the confidentiality of all of the protected health data sets that we have. So that's I have to share.
Our next speaker is one of my close colleagues. Steve Goodman is a professor of epidemiology and the head of our epidemiology division here, also an associate dean for clinical and translational science education. But the most important role that Steve plays, at least the reason I wanted him on this panel, is as the director of a large effort here on campus, affectionately known as Metrics, but the focus of which is on the integrity and reproducibility of scientific data, something on the science side which has been very greatly called in question. And although the state agencies may or may not think about the world that way, we certainly do here. Steve.
So thank you for having me. As Mark indicated, I don't come from exactly the world that many of you come from. But we do, in the space that I inhabit, talk about many of the same issues. And actually, I would love to ask you, does anybody here know what the origin of the word statistics is? No. So it derived from the early observation just a few hundred years ago that even though you couldn't predict who would live, who would die, who would marry, who would divorce, that when you looked at it on the state level, they were remarkably constant. So these are numbers that are characteristics of the state, statistics. So I want to thank you all for having given birth to the discipline that has kept me alive through my entire career. So although Emily said that sometimes administrative data sets are not viewed with the, you know, having the highest scientific rigor, they in fact were the lens through which we saw the possibility of the power of numbers aggregated over populations. So what I'm going to do is one debate I've been very much involved in and is that of sharing medical research data, particularly clinical trials. And I'm going to show you a little glimpse of the conversations that have been going on there. I'll make a few of the linkages to some of the issues that have been talked about here. They're very similar. But I'll leave it to the discussion and your own imaginations as I go through to make all the linkages. And I think that it's interesting to see a community who has been struggling with some of the same issues, how they've solved some things, how they have not solved other things, and how the need and how the issues that come up in the discussion are very, very similar to the issues that come up here. So let's see how we, I don't know how to do this. Well, there we go. So this is a graph, which I could spend actually half an hour describing. You're just going to have to take my word about what this means. And basically what this is a representation of a meta-analysis that was done through what's called the Early Breast Cancer Trialist Cooperative. And this was published in the early 1980s. And what this shows is 26 studies. Oh, I can't do it. Let's see. Oh, there we go. 26 studies that all of which were inconclusive about the effect of tamoxifen on breast cancer, but these trialists working together and agreeing ahead of time to share their data came up with a conclusion that tamoxifen was actually very, very effective as a treatment in early breast cancer. And what's more important than this is the number of this was published in, I think, roughly 1985. But then this is a list of all the publications that came from this collaborative group of researchers who each one was doing their own studies, but agreeing to share their data produced a virtual avalanche of data on the efficacy of a variety of treatments and in breast cancer therapy, and it's been one of the most productive collaboratives in medicine. So this shows as one of many benefits of sharing data in medicine. Let's see if I can get this. Now to underscore, let's see if we can get rid of that. Okay, and these are some more. So it just goes on and on and on. But what they had to do was agree on the key things to measure, and they had to agree to share it with each other. This was no small thing, and as was mentioned before, a lot of this is about relationships. A lot of what was achieved there was through the relationship set up between this group of people, all of whom were fighting for better prognosis in women with breast cancer. Now, here are a bunch of other controversies. You probably recognize many of these drugs. Fen-phen, Vioxx, Avandia, Tamiflu, all of which involved in controversies having to do with published data that was either incomplete or misleading. You're probably surprised to see the Oscar effect here. I'll introduce you to that and make the connection. So here we have Julie, what's her name? She won the Oscar last year. Julia Moore, yes, wonderful actress. She said, and this is what she said in her speech, "I read an article that said winning an Oscar could lead to living 5 years longer. If that's true, I'd really like to thank the Academy because my husband is younger than me." That was very funny, but actually this is a real sore point for me because I was involved in the publication of the article from which that came in just 2001 in the Annals of Internal Medicine, and it was an article that said that you could live 4 years longer if you had an Oscar. I won't go through the whole history, but we were very concerned about the conclusions of this article, and we asked that the author put the raw data up on the web so others could look at it, and in fact, he did for one day. It came down because he said the Canadian there were Canadian rules that said that this violated certain confidentiality rules. Apparently, it was not proper to reveal the names of actors and actresses appearing in the credits of movies. So it came down. It took 5 years for another researcher to get the raw data set. Actually, it wasn't quite the same one, and this one reanalyzed it and confirmed, in fact, that the original Oscar effect was not real. And this did lead to a few published articles. This is from 2012. Suggesting that this was actually a bit bogus, but it shows that everything that is published is not true, and that sometimes you have to go back and look at the data and see what was left out, how did they analyze it, et cetera. And this was not easy to get, and purportedly for confidentiality reasons, I think it may have been others. So getting more serious, this is a recurrent theme in drug approval and drug monitoring, where there are records everywhere pertaining to both the efficacy and safety of the medications we take. And we find over and over and over that when we get more complete linkages between all the little different pieces of evidence, some of which sometimes is in the FDA hands but never makes it to the literature. In fact, there's quite a lot of that. We find that the drugs we take don't quite have the risk-benefit that we thought. And this has promoted an avalanche of research and commentary and a move to do a lot more sharing of data and having more open data. And these are just a few examples of headlines that have come from investigations that have resulted. And I won't go through all these. So here's some more headlines. New York Times, give data to the people. This is in New England Journal of Medicine by one of our own faculty, preparing for responsible sharing of clinical trial data, raw data of clinical trials within reach. And this is a particularly interesting editorial. This is by Jeff Drazen, the editor of the New England Journal of Medicine. You'll see why it's particularly interesting. You'll see the date at the top, very, very important, January of 2014. He was a member of an Institute of Medicine committee that I was also on, trying to draw up rules for sharing of clinical trial data, which is he outlines here. He has another data editorial that just appeared a couple weeks ago, almost the same title. But this one actually inadvertently provoked a firestorm. Why? Well, this was I'm not going to read the whole thing here, but this was the first through paragraphs, and I'll just highlight the key words. And this is going to reflect the some of the complications involved in data sharing in the medical sphere, and I think echoing some of the things I've heard. It says, the aerial view of the concept of data sharing is beautiful. What could be better than having high-quality information carefully reexamined for the possibility that new nuggets of useful data are lying there previously unseen? Skip a little. However, many of us who've actually conducted clinical research have concerns. The first is someone not involved in the generation collection of the data may not understand the choices. And he goes on to say how they could make mistakes. How could they make the proper judgments? But this is what produced the conflagration. A second concern is that people had nothing to do with the design and execution of the study, but use another group's data for their own ends, possibly stealing from the research productivity planned by the data gatherers, or even use the data to disprove what the original investigators had posited. There's concern among some frontline researchers that the system will be taken over by research parasites. Ooh. Now let's look at the next piece from Jeff Drazen. Now, look at this date. 1/21/125. Why is that relevant? Well, the New England Journal is not published like the New York Times. New England Journal publishes once every week, and you expect to see the next one, 1/28. The social media firestorm was so intense that the editor, just 2 weeks ago, felt he had to backtrack and explain that he was just saying what he'd heard from other people. And we completely support data sharing. Yes. But the point is that these are some of the forces and tensions within the health field, even for something that you would think would be somewhat uncontroversial. So let me just, I'm just going to finish up with some summaries of discussions of two groups. One is the Institute of Medicine, and the other is the PCORI, which is one of the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute. This is actually a figure from the Institute of Medicine report on clinical trial data sharing, and if it looks complicated, it is. The point is, what data to share and where to share it is very complicated. You could go all the way back to the death certificate and find new things. And where along that chain of administrative data collection is the right place to share data to make new discoveries is a very complicated question, and I think one that faces the group today. So why data sharing? Well, most of these have been already explored, ensure accurate analyses, make the best use of data, speed innovation, allow patients and disease communities, and here I would say citizens, to learn more about their condition, and I would say that certainly applies generally here, ensure that participants and patients are not exposed to unnecessary risk, and, tell that to the residents of Flint, Michigan, improve strategic planning about new questions and research directions. All of these have direct parallels to kind of issues we've talked about here. But why is it hard? Concerns about privacy, confidentiality, complexity of data, minimizes the return on investment of the investigators, no agreed-upon models or platforms for sharing, concerns about what are called rogue analyses, that is, the analyses you get from data sharing by untrained researchers or even by trained researchers can be wrong themselves and can be used to confuse and promulgate incorrect conclusions. There are regulations, we'll hear, I'm sure, this from Hank, that preclude certain kind of sharing. And finally, and this does have relevance, I think, for this group, among the manufacturers, they are very worried that if safety signals are found in clinical trial data sets, that they will be sued for failing to warn that there was a hazard there. So you release data sets in a certain way, and researchers find hazards that may or may not have been discoverable before. You could imagine that an agency or an entity might be afraid that they would be called to account for not having made best use of their own data. So I'll just finish with these this last set of concerns that were expressed in an IOM data sharing workshop. They pointed out that a change in academic culture is needed. We've already talked about that. We need to better understand the risks of misleading analysis and re-identification. Again, an issue here. Different models might be, sharing models might be appropriate for different kinds and ages of data sets. We might be more willing to share data that's years old than that came out yesterday, but on the other hand, that's less useful, particularly for administrative purposes. New forms of consent need to be developed. The elephant in the room is that for all this sharing, nobody gave explicit consent for it. And we might need different legal, regulatory, and ethical frameworks for who really owns that data. Is it the person who supplied it? Is it the government entity? Is it the investigator? And our use of this is actually a question I asked every group. Can I download this data for use by a class? Completely innocent. And nobody had an answer. And you would think this would be one of the best uses. So I'll just leave you with those questions and thank you for and look forward to the discussion.
It keeps getting more interesting. We asked Hank Greely, who's an icon on this campus. He's the Dean and Kate Edelman Professor of Law and an international expert in the interface between law, ethics, and biomedical research. We asked him not to prepare comments, but to comment on our comments. Hank, what do you got to say? We'll come back to him after a few questions later, but I thought he'd get a first crack.
I'm feeling kind of uncomfortable being described as an icon, since I've always thought of myself as kind of an iconoclast.
But there it goes. So I will be brief. I'm a real big believer in the value of biomedical research and the value of data sharing leading to better biomedical research.
Sure.
And you know that when I start a comment like that, there's a but. There are actually three buts. First but, Stanford is a great home for a lot of omes. The genome, the epigenome, the microbiome, the proteome. But the biggest of all the omes, and this is not just at Stanford, is the hyperbolome. The amount of hype around current biomedical research is astronomical. It's beyond astronomical. It's intergalactic. It reminds me of a current presidential candidate sometimes. And it's a bad thing. I mean, the public has heard for 30 years that we're about to cure everything. And they've begun to notice that we haven't. Progress is being made, but we can't hype it too much. And the point for that is, and this maybe goes more to the researchers than to the people providing, opening the data, we shouldn't try to tell people that opening state data for medical research is going to cure cancer, the heartbreak of psoriasis, and everything else. It will be a useful step, but it's not going to be a cure. And the temptation to overclaim is so strong, particularly in today's political climate, where everything either has to be absolutely the greatest thing, greatest idea ever come up with, or absolutely, if it's your opponent's, the most terrible idea that anybody has ever enunciated. The fact that something is, on balance, more likely than not to lead to some real good isn't a very politically saleable comment today. But it's the reality, and we need to stick with it. Second point, and this I think is more for the data people, but also for the researchers, we need to not exaggerate the ability to protect technically the confidentiality of individuals' identities. Not only is hacking always going to be with us, but the real problem in biomedical research at the individual level is if you've got data that's rich enough to be helpful, you've got data that's rich enough to be able to re-identify. 20 years ago, the state of Massachusetts found this out when it opened its state employee health records on a purely de-identified basis to researchers. And over the weekend, one such researcher came up with and presented to the Boston Globe the health records of the governor of the state of Massachusetts using two other databases, the DMV database and the voting registration database. We can't promise protection. We can promise to try, but we can't promise that we're going to be able to keep people's identities secret, because we can't, at least not and still provide meaningful data. The third point, arguably, is the only ethics and law point here, but I'd summarize it as no nasty surprises. There are legal barriers, but they are manageable, I think. There are ethical concerns, but they also are manageable if done appropriately. But ethics, law, the bigger issues here, I think, are really public relations and politics with a small p. You don't want nasty surprises. You don't want people to wake up and read in the LA Times or the San Francisco Chronicle or CNN or wherever that they've just been identified as someone who carries a particular disease because the state released a database that some researcher then released and someone online then re-identified them. You don't want them to have that happen. You also don't want them to just then, for the first time, realize that anybody was releasing their data. So we need to have people, I think first, we actually need to understand better what people find sensitive. What data do they care about? I give the state or a state contractor information on when my car crosses one of the Bay Area bridges every time I cross a bridge, thanks to Fast Track. I do it because on a good day, it cuts a few minutes off my trip. I get something back from it. I give that data up. If my data is being used for health research, there are two differences. There's not an immediate convenience benefit to myself, and oftentimes I have no idea that that's happening. We need to figure out what people actually find sensitive, and I think some empirical research would actually be useful there, and then make sure that people understand what's available, what's planned to be available, and perhaps in appropriate circumstances provide an opt-out. Because the worst thing you want to do, and I think this is a matter of law, ethics, and public relations, is to give people nasty surprises. So I think this is a good thing. I think it is not going to be a simple thing. It's worth pursuing, but it needs to be done carefully and thoughtfully, as I'm sure all of you agree with. Thank you.
So no disappointment, Hank. That's what I hoped you would push us to. In any event, every speaker, starting with me, went a little over because I think this is pretty rich content. So we only have a few minutes left for questions, but I'd be very happy to entertain a few. Over here. Just wait for the mic.
that on? There it is, it's on, okay. Okay, so here's my question. This was great, by the way. What I'm curious about is, I think everyone would agree that you as researchers, you're trained professionals, you have the capacities and knowledge to be able to effectively use linked data in your settings, linked data from the government. I recall a session that I did with Mike Wilkening and some others from the state with journalists. And at that session, Scott's nodding, I think he was there. Yeah. At that session, I think the journalist said, could we also get these data, the linked data? And you can imagine they'd want it for investigative pieces and such. And by that same token, I could see a setting in which like entrepreneurs could make a good case for why they need linked data. We've got some entrepreneurs and startups in this room. And I'm kind of curious if you, as trained professionals, think that really that's okay, or really should it be only in the hands of researchers?
I'll let the researchers think.
I'm on. Ultimately, I think that's both a social and political decision. I will say, I'll just comment on the conversations that we had about that with regard to clinical trial data. And that was of intense concern. Could anybody, if this data was going to be open, could anybody get it? And where the various groups and committees I've been on have decided is that there would be a sort of honest broker third party, and that the minimum standard would be that they could actually submit a protocol that would say how they were going to use it and for what purposes. That was it. We wouldn't judge whether they were legitimate researchers, but we considered the ability to write that protocol and description, in a sense, sufficient license to do it. Whether that's right or wrong, it's clearly a balancing act. And you could easily argue, and I'm not the one to do it, that making the same data available to investigative reporters, even without a protocol, is going to be of great social benefit. You could also imagine that opens the door rather wide for other uses or even misuses by the same reporters. So I can't comment on that. I will just say where the balance seems to have been struck, and there are actually people still on both sides calling for both more and less restrictive policies, is that you demonstrate in some meaningful way how you're going to use the data, and that there's an honest sort of neutral party broker that says, yes, this is of adequate social value, and these people have the technical skill to do it such that the data will be released to them. And even with that, you have to have data use agreements to prevent the release of information that might harm individuals. But I think others on the panel might want to speak to this as well.
I'll just throw out one recent anecdote in the private sector data analysis. And I don't remember all the details, but there was the teenage girl who began to get pregnancy-related information because Facebook or someone had crunched her online postings and decided that she was pregnant, which in fact she was, but her father didn't realize it, and bad things happened. The government data actually, potentially, I think, worries me a lot less than the sort of private data that we've given up willingly and sort of quasi-knowingly for immediate convenience. But this is not just your problem or research problem. It's a big social issue that I don't think we're anywhere close to having come to grips with.
Just taking the prerogative of the chair, I just wanted to underscore what Hank said, which is, we talk about this very much, in sort of the narrow biomedical research context, but in fact, each and every one of you in this room probably more frequently than once a week, maybe once a day, checks off an I accept button. You walk into Starbucks and you want their internet, their Wi-Fi, and you just hit the accept. And you don't know all the things that it's allowed them to do that ultimately would result in your father knowing you're pregnant. Because in fact, that's, the private sector owns way more data than we do, despite all of our expensive efforts to collect it. And I think it is important as we think about many of these issues that we not somehow segregate off, oh my God, health data, it's so wildly sensitive that we can't even, or social service data, that we can't even imagine treating it the way our society has started to treat the transactional data that follows us from morning till night, the GPS that your phone has, so that someone can literally track your movement from the moment you get up until you return to one place. So it's a complicated question.
Mark, can I just
add,
sure.
I can just add
Please.
To that? So it is a really, I mean, I think in the federated data, it creates more challenges. But I think I was just at a conference called Informed Health recently, thinking about how we bring data together, how we use big data, which is separate from open data. But just to that point, having some of the folks from different industries and how they're using data to do this analysis and make decisions, they're so far ahead in the space of using satellite data for purchasing power in parking lots. And so I think as we're thinking, I mean, it's really impressive that they can tell, you know, if it's going to be a high sales day or a low sales day based on this. And so I think one of the challenges is I think to your point, this exists, but how do we start to use some of the open data? And I think some of the other data around housing, around park access, I think there's a unique opportunity there for some of the social determinants in thinking about health data and linking with open data.
I would certainly agree with that. More questions?
No.
Maybe people are getting hungry. A question over here.
Yeah, for Professor Greely in particular, but the issue of how we would figure out what data people are concerned about releasing or not. I mean, it seems to me that a lot of people just are in support of the public good, but how we would know about that or not, it seems like it'd be hard to assess, but it does seem like it'd be an exciting endeavor. But related to that, the example you gave about the governor and one or two others that I've heard about, and I've looked at the literature a fair bit, are the I think I can count those examples on one hand, and I'm not aware of any harm that's come from any of those, whereas the real issue is the databases that had the fully identified information, the clinical databases or the person talking to someone else, even though they know about HIPAA, but they're still talking and the people in the waiting room can hear or whatever it is. It feels to me like there's an over... too much attention to the issue of reasonably de-identified data. If we do a good job, as we often have in government, or we always do in government, of de-identifying it reasonably, it seems like the balance has swung towards the direction of not releasing it, or not swung, it's always been, and I'm just curious how you see that scale of releasing it with the potential for harm being very, very small.
So I think reasonably de-identified or reasonably unre-identifiable is the right way to go, because otherwise, you can't release anything. You can't promise that things won't be re-identifiable, particularly as more and more assets come online that you can link. It's the linking of various databases more than anything else that makes things re-identifiable. Genealogical folks are putting incredible amounts of stuff up there because they're interested in genealogy, but you tie that to something else and things begin to get accessible. I ride a 20-year-old bicycle that was cheap when I bought it. I lock it, but part of my strategy is not to have a bike that's valuable enough for anybody to steal. I think for many of us, our safety from re-identification is we're not important enough for anybody to care. That's always been my hope. But you know, cool. As it gets easier and easier to do re-identification, the cost-benefit ratio begins to change. And I can imagine re-identification being done for advertising and commercial purposes if it gets cheap enough, let alone other kinds of people who are, you know, you're the dad investigating your teenage daughter's new boyfriend. A whole bunch of things could happen. The could is too strong. Reasonably de-identifiable, I think, is the right way to think about it. And reasonable is always a fuzzy word that my first-year law students hear way too much of. They think they're coming to hear answers, and instead they hear reasonable over and over. But I think that's the way we got to go.
All right, we'll take one more.
Can I make one comment that I wanted to make before the question? It's just a single point, which is that none of this, and maybe, is free. And this is one point I didn't have in my last slide, that the cost of doing data sharing and preparing data for sharing has to be borne by somebody. And those are dollars, I know, particularly in state government, that will not be spent on programs. And the pricing of this is something not to be ignored. It's not a trivial expense to do everything that we're talking about, or even a few of the things we're talking about. So I hope this afternoon sometimes that, you know, some beginning assessment of where those costs are incurred and what the trade-offs are can be talked about, because it's not just a matter of dumping what we have, as has been pointed out. Anyway, yes.
This is a question for Dr. Putnam-Hornstein. I really enjoyed your talk. I think it was very consistent with how we've sort of experienced trying to get microdata from the state for what we would consider very appropriate and applicable purposes. And I wondered if there was, in both cases, there was very good, you know, relationships. People both here at Stanford and in the agency wanted to do the research or thought it was useful. And what we found is a lot of times things get all the way through, we clear all the hurdles, and then it stops at the lawyer's office. It's on someone's desk. It's not clear that they can do it, and it's where projects go to die. And I wondered if you had any suggestions for either workarounds, or if you were aware of any discussions of making explicit policies where, for appropriate use, either, you know, microdata can be sent to a state agency, linked there, and then de-identified, sent, you know, stripped and sent back, or if there's any ways that you've really, tips you have to get the microdata, basically.
great question, one where there's probably not any quick or easy answer. What I have found is that even with relationships, you also kind of need that internal champion who is going to make sure that when it stops at a lawyer's desk, there's more conversation and it's revived. So that's obviously a huge part of it. I also think that you bring up a really good point, and it's something that Steve brought up as well, which is kind of this kind of third-party broker. So one of the things that we are very, very clear about is that we have our work that we do with the identified data, which is just to establish the linkage. And separately, we have these very strict protocols around, once the data have been linked and de-identified, what are the different research use cases? And I've found that sometimes we try to kind of package that all up into one protocol or one conversation. And frankly, the lawyers who are not researchers and are kind of thinking about it in a simplistic fashion fail to appreciate that none of our researchers ever see the identifiable data. It's with our engineering team where they're just linking it. It's on a non-networked workstation. So we've just spent a lot of time kind of making it very clear that there are two parts of our work, and I think that's been helpful.
And just a thought on dealing with lawyers. Right. We are trained, and our incentives are to be cautious and to be conservative and protective. But we are also ultimately servants of our clients. Now, who the client is exactly in a government context can be a little tricky. But if somebody who is high enough level says, I want this to be done, the lawyer will almost always be able to figure out a way for it to be done. Figuring out ways for things to be done is a big part of our job, but we need to know that that's what our client slash boss important person really wants us to do. So recruiting, getting support from somewhere high up and getting that support expressed is not a bad way to get something out of a lawyer's office.